What are you doing here?
She said, I came for you. I've something to tell you. I sat up, and she sat next to me. She looked at me. She looked at me, and she said, you're not well, are you? I said, no, Mom, I'm not. She took her hand, and she stroked my face. It was the warmth and love of a mother's touch that I've not felt for so many years. She looked at me, and she said, of all my children, I never thought that you would be the first. I said, yeah, I guess so. I have to go now. I said, Mom, are you happy now? She looked at me and she said, yes. I'm happy. Your father is here. Your aunt and your uncle. Your grandparents. So you know, when you come, we'll all be waiting for you. She said, I have to go now. And you take care. And she left. I woke up in cold sweat. I reached out for my cigarette. And I analyzed what had happened. Was I so special that my mother came in my dream to tell me a message? I believed when the doctors told me I had 2.5 years to live. I went out and I bought a coffin. I took my obituary pictures. John's death before the conference. I thought and I thought and I thought. Was I going to allow all this to happen? Or was my subconscious playing games? I decided then that I wasn't going to stay home and die. I was going to go out and fight for my life. Fight for everything that I believe in. I was not going to stay home and wither away and die like so many other patients. And you know, the strangest thing in life is that whenever you have to make a decision that would probably change your whole life, it always comes from a death. John's death. Why? Why does it always have to come from a death?
If you are a HIV or AIDS patient in Singapore, you are likely to lead a secret life without your colleagues or family knowing. If they do know, you are likely to be shunned, fired, or excommunicated. If you are jobless and poor, you are likely not to see the doctor or buy any medication because there's little subsidy and you can't afford $1,500 a month. If you don't get treatment, you are likely to get very sick. If you go to a normal hospital, you're likely to be transferred immediately to the communicable disease center. If you are warded, you are likely to encounter nurses who do not want to touch you. If you are dying, you're likely to be turned away by hospices. When you are dead, you will be cremated within 24 hours. So we've come to scene 9, which is the question and answer session. For each evening of Without, a different individual is invited to read the transcript of Paddy's performance in cadence with the documentation. I'm glad to introduce Caroline Fernandez, who has been reading for us this evening. We have now approximately 15 minutes for a dialogue session with Caroline, and also joining us from Action for AIDS Singapore is Avin Tan. You're welcome to join us in the rehearsal studio downstairs or remain in this black box here to watch documentation from Paddy's Q&A session in the middle of the play, also from 1999.
All right, this is my favorite set. For those of you who need to go to the toilet, I think you better do it now. Now, this is the Q&A, okay? We have two microphones at the top, two microphones at the bottom. If you are afraid to ask a question, write it down, my beautiful Caroline here, we'll read it out. Okay, now, please, don't be so Singaporean, don't be so polite. If you have something to say, I mean, say it. If you think I deserve this disease and you want me to know it, I want you to say it. Let it off your chest. All right, now we're going to start from the balcony and then we're going to move down to the floor. As you can see, we've locked in to the IRC. This is not just a regional forum, it's now a global forum. Or stylo, global forum. All right, any questions from upstairs? You can ask me anything you like. Don't worry about it. Come on. Yes.
That is a question from the floor. Exactly how did you get the AIDS virus?
Okay.
Hello. Thanks for joining us downstairs. Yeah, it takes a bit of time to come down all the way from upstairs. We have about 15 minutes because Paddy is keeping us on time. His Q&A session, this edited version, is about 18 minutes long. Yeah? So I'd like to introduce first our two guests, our beautiful Caroline, as what Paddy would call you, who has been reading for us this evening, and of course, Mr. Avin Tan. Those of you who are not familiar with Avin, he's the second person supported by AFA to come out publicly with his HIV status back in 2012. Yeah, just a brief bio about Caroline. This, she wrote her own bio, so. No. I invited all of them to write their own bio, and she gave the most cute bio of all. Caroline is a happily employed minion in the corporate world. In the past, she has been a lawyer, stand-up comedian, MC, actor, and member of Action for AIDS Singapore. She was privileged to have been involved in several TNS productions and was awarded the Red Ribbon Award in 2013 for her contributions to AFA. She met Paddy in 1999 when she interviewed him for an article. What was supposed to be a two-hour session became a two-day chat fest, leading to her involvement in the original 1999 production of Completely Without Character and becoming a Paddy Chew groupie. She is therefore extremely grateful and humbled to be able to participate in this project and to be able to revisit Paddy and the gang from 16 years ago. Thank you. Okay, and of course, there's someone else that I have to introduce, and he's none other than, I cannot don't introduce, yeah, Alvin Tan, who is, yeah. So Alvin worked with Harish and of course Paddy to do the original production in 1999, yeah. Okay, so I guess we'll just open it up to the floor first. Anybody has any questions for any of us? Yes, Robin. Wait. You have to use the mic because we are live streaming on.
I have a question for Caroline. So you were the stage manager then, and now you're reading this.
No.
No, you were not.
No.
Oh, so what was your involvement? Because we saw on the running slideshow.
I was actually doing an interview. I was interviewing Paddy for an article.
Right.
And so I got to shadow him.
Right.
So I got to shadow him at a rehearsal process. And that was the photographs that you saw.
I see. So from that, and right now, what kind of a position are you taking when reading this? Are you reminiscing? Are you trying to capture what was happening? As an actor, as a performer, how do you approach this?
It was very difficult because on one hand, I wasn't sure if I wanted to just read the text because, you know, you just cannot be Paddy, right? Mm. And then on the other hand, you also, that thing comes through, you start acting like Paddy and trying to talk like Paddy. I guess it's a little bit of reminiscing. It really is a revisit. A lot of our memories are imperfect. And something that Zihan has said in the last few days really resonated with me, the idea that we now look back after 16 years and we see nuances that we missed, we might see some flaws that we missed, and we might see some perfections that we missed. Mm-hmm. So it's a completely different journey, I felt.
Finally, is it very emotional? How emotional? Can you talk us through the emotional quality of this?
Wow, yeah, it was.
Because it's once off, right?
Yes, yes. I still remember when Zihan came to see me, through Elvin and all, and both of them, I will get y'all for this. They both told me it was research. So, you know, so Zihan came and I had this very fun lunchtime gossiping away about everybody and everything. And then towards the end of it, then he says, actually, we have readers and would you like to be a reader? And I was like, oh my God, yes. Thank you. Because just talking about the project and talking about the research and all that already started bringing back memories. And then Zihan sent me the video clip from 1999, and I didn't think much about it, so I played it during office hours, and I hope my boss is not watching it. So I was playing it during office hours, and within 5-10 minutes, I started crying. And I'm not a crying person. Yeah. So I was like crying. So I scolded Zihan. And then Zihan started sending me things from his research. He sent me photographs, and I found myself crying again. He sent me articles, again. I did tell Zihan, and I said it's probably menopause, but never mind. Why are you laughing? And I was telling Zihan as well, when I came into the space, when it was still work in progress, I had a lot of goosebumps. And every time I came back to the space and I heard another reader, it was just goosebumps all over again. And so I was saying that it was a groundbreaking project back in 1999, and TNS was so brave to do it. And now, 16 years later, it's in a way, in a very different way, it's a groundbreaking project. And it's brought that groundbreaking project of 1999 to a whole new generation. Because trying to restage the play, and I think Elfin was the one who said it, right? You, who can ever restage this, right? You can't, right? And that also started resonating with me as we were reading. There's no way you can do it. And if Zihan didn't do this the way he did it, it will never surface ever again, you know? Yeah. So it's multi-feelings, multi-reactions, you know? Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Caroline. And just to provide those people a little bit more context, Elfian reviewed the original production in 1999, and this is his review in the Straits Times. So if you're interested, you can read this review. And of course, he's here, so you can speak to him too. Anybody else? Any other questions? Yes, Nora.
When you posted a slideshow of the previous production during rehearsals, during the opening party, I think there's also a party at Sugar. Yes. Yeah. And then you showed pictures of Drama Center, which to me, so it became without it became, as she was saying, you know, going back, memories, etc. So even for those of us who, I knew Paddy, not as a friend, but we suddenly knew who each other was and we did speak. But Drama Center, there were so many pictures of Drama Center. I just needed to say, there's so many pictures of Drama Center that it's not just that we, memories of Paddy whom we know and all the points about everything about AIDS, how far it's not gone or how far it has gone in the 16 years. But it's also how much I personally miss Drama Center. I thought I needed to say that.
Yeah, and I guess that's also a good point to turn into the conversation with Avin, perhaps. You know, a very important thing is the educational aspect of this particular project too, you know. And one of the things I was reading out, I read the child's voiceover. So the parts that I'm reading upstairs originally was a voiceover and it was read by a child. And one of the things that concluded the scene before we came down was all the stigmatization of people living with AIDS and HIV. So I'm wondering, maybe you can update us from your position, how much has changed, how much has not changed, or, yeah.
Well, simple comparison would be when Paddy first came out, it's a huge thing. And then when I came out in 2012, it was almost meh. We were preparing for my coming out. We took 6 months and we had no one else to base the coming out on, and so we based it on Paddy and a few other clients that we were working with, and we were worried about my parents disowning me, what if my friends, what if I got kicked out of school, and so on and so forth. When the news rolled out, articles rolled out, and then there was nothing. There was just silence. Either people didn't speak about it, or when they know, they didn't know how to ask a question. But 2 years later, last year, during World AIDS Day, my parents, my mom and my sis actually took to Facebook to show their support of my coming out and whatever I was doing. And so yes, things have changed a lot. HIV has almost become a non-issue today. And a lot more people are more knowledgeable of what it is, how it affects people. So yes, it is. It's changed a lot. It's improved a lot for person living HIV. But at the very same time, when I work with other clients who are newly diagnosed, just a couple of weeks ago, he was actually asked to move out of his home, and we have a lot of calls coming in from officers who they're suspecting someone in the office is either living HIV, has been diagnosed with HIV, or they're preparing to hire someone with HIV, and they would be made to sit in different cubicles or far away from the main office area, can't use the pantry, can't use the same utensils as well because they're very worried that it will spread, or it might spread to central aircon system. So things like that still exist. Yeah. So we still have quite a bit of way to educate the rest of the public and also to challenge or reduce stigma and discrimination. I don't believe we can ever reach zero, although that's one of the goals that we're trying to reach. Yeah.
Thank you, Avin. We don't really have much time to go in depth, but one of the things that is a great resource is the Act, and it's available for you to pick up right by the door. And it's actually a publication by AFA that goes way back to 1999. And Caroline actually wrote a review about the play itself, which is in the Act back then in 1999. So if you are interested in hearing what Caroline has to say, yeah, you can read this. And of course, you can pick up your copy of the Act. And if you haven't noticed, there's the beautiful donation box right beside there. Yeah, and they would need your support too. They have been immensely supportive of this production too. Yeah. Okay, enough of the advertisement on my side. Any other questions, burning questions? How much time? Okay, Faiza.
Just want to ask you, we say when you came out, there was silence, right? And you say you were expecting something, but there wasn't anything. What question were you expecting?
I wasn't expecting question per se, but I was expecting at least a response to it. Response whether it's from the internet or from my relatives. And then because I came out during the 8th Singapore AIDS Conference, which was December, and then shortly after was Chinese New Year, so I was very nervous going to have reunion dinner. It was steamboat and everything. I wasn't sure how my aunties would react, or would they share or mind sharing eating from the same steamboat or not. And then there was nothing. So there was nothing on that. There was only just one small little forum on, I can't remember whether it was Sammy Boy or was it Laksa something. And so the usual things went on that forum saying, he's gay, he deserves it, that's why, you know, blah, 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 that kind of thing. But it was just that one little blurb there. So nothing else. Yeah. And, I mean, beside that, then there were, all the friends were messaging me, showing their support. But, yeah, it was pretty much silence after that.
Any other questions? Yes, Alfie.
Just a very quick comment. When I first watched the screening just now, I really thought there was Paddy's voice. That is how stupid I am. for at least 5 minutes. And then I thought, wow, okay. You know, it was very interesting because I was wondering, okay, so this is a spokesperson for HIV at that time. And then you start thinking, okay, but, you know, the fact that he was camp, you start to wonder, okay, could you have had a more ideal sort of spokesperson? Could you, what if it was a straight person who came out rather than, you know, a gay person? Does this entrench the stereotypes or does this fight it? And I really like Caroline, I think you did an amazing job. You're a gay man in a woman's body, and I mean that as a compliment. I mean that totally as a compliment. but question for Avin. I'm just curious, and since you've mentioned it, I feel it's okay to ask. When you came out with someone with HIV, did you feel so you had to come out in terms of your sexuality? Because I realized Paddy didn't quite do that. It was, you know, you sort of guessed along the way, you know, his, yeah, you know, how camp he was on stage and designer goods, etc. You sort of sensed it, you know. So I'm wondering whether you had to satisfy a certain public curiosity about it and what the other kinds of, say, intrusions into your privacy you might have faced. Like people asking, how did you get it or do you regret it? I mean, you know, that they shouldn't be asking.
Yeah, we did prime the interviewers to not ask questions like how you get it and things like that. We did play down the fact that I was gay, at least in the first year. The decision was made to protect myself and not to draw too much attention to that. And also at the same time, not to further entrench a stereotype that, again, another gay man, another person living HIV. So yes, there was some effort made in playing it down, but I remember in the first Straits Times interview, it was really in bold, or at least in the article, I think somewhere, that gay men, age 27, and it also wrote a little bit about my story of how I contracted HIV. And last year during AIDS conference, we just made the decision to just completely embrace it. And I opened my speech with, I'm a gay man living HIV. Yeah. So that has changed too, being gay in Singapore.
Any final questions? We have about a minute. Anybody? Okay, one quick one.
It's actually for Avin. So I'm wondering now, how's the issue with access to medication, and if there's greater access, then there should be fewer people getting sick and dying? I'm really not sure what's happening with that. Could you?
83% still passed away due to HIV and AIDS, according to official records last year. The year before. But at the same time, there is a greater access to, an ease of access to treatment. Treatment, I think somewhere in the script it was mentioned 1,500 per month. Now it costs about 400-ish, still relatively expensive for an average Singaporean, but plenty of subsidy is available. Yeah, and because now MediSafe, MediFund, MediShield, Medical Assistance Fund can all be tapped into, and more subsidy are coming. Many people are working towards that, and AFA also provides some subsidy as well. So if that's
specifically the Paddy Chew Patient Welfare
correct.
Fund. The welfare fund that is named after Paddy Chew.
Yeah, we renamed it in 2011, 2012. To Paddy Chew Medicare Fund. And that's the price of original drugs. Generic drugs can be as cheap as $56 a month now. So definitely can access. We will never leave someone alone or stranded when they're diagnosed with HIV.
Okay, the Q&A session just finished upstairs. So as Paddy would say, the show must go on. There are three more scenes, and let's go back into it.
The phone will ring.
Hi,
Paddy.
Yeah,
it's me calling from Amsterdam. Girl, why don't you pack your bags and come to Amsterdam? Down here, we have the doctors, we have the funding, we have the support group. Almost everybody is HIV. You will just be another phase, no problem. In Singapore, they're going to treat you like a leper. Throw you one side at Tan Tock Seng, throw away the key. So why are you staying there? What? You want to fight for changes in legislation? You want to be an activist? You want to be lobby? For God's sake, you can't even have a condom ad in that country, okay? So you pack your bags and you come here, okay? Now I gotta go. Okay, bye. The phone will ring. Good morning, Mr. Chew. Housing Development Board of Singapore. We are pleased to inform you that your application for a HDB flat has been approved. But however, Mr. Chew, you declared that you are HIV positive. As such, you are not permitted the home protection scheme, which is the HPS. I'm sorry, Mr. Chew. I'm just one person. Policies are policies, and they can't be changed. But look at the bright side. At least you have your flat. All right, Mr. Chew, I wish you good morning and goodbye. Phone will ring. Paddy, hi.
Yeah,
how are you today? Okay, now I've been talking with some of the doctors, and apparently, you have not been taking your medication for more than 1 year. Now, I understand it makes you dysfunctional. And I know you want to do the play, the Candlelight Memorial, World AIDS Day. But you know, as a friend and a doctor, please, please go on your medication soon. You know, Paddy, if anything happens to you, the issue might die. Paddy, I want you to take the medication soon. Don't be so stubborn. As a friend and doctor, take my advice. Go under medication now. You know, I have a friend. His name is Windy. Strange name. And I also have another friend. His name is David. When I was first diagnosed with HIV virus, I had to go all the way to Amsterdam to seek treatment. When I arrived in Amsterdam, they had just buried David. So I had lunch with Windy. And I asked him. I said, Wynn, when you met David, did he tell you about his status? Yes, he did. I said, Wynn, then why didn't you take precaution? Now you are sick and you are dying. He said, Paddy, you and the whole world will never understand. I said, try me. He said, what was I when David met me? I was an abeng. I spoke Hokkien. I worked in a pig farm, slaughtering pigs for the supermarket. Then came this crazy young man who took me away and who gave me a new life. So what could I give him? The only thing I have to give him is my life. I thought about it, and I thought it was such a beautiful story. Can all of you here today look at HIV and people with AIDS through the eyes of wind? Can you love them? Can you give them the chance to have a full and normal life? Or in your eyes and the eyes of society, they should be shunned and locked away and never allowed in public, discriminated against? Can you? Can you look at them as normal and loving people, as human beings, as fellow Singaporeans? So I ask you now, can society be compassionate? Can society love them? I ask you now, please, can you let them? Can you let them come home? candlelight memorial is a reminder. The only honorary guest will make the announcement, and after which, the first flame will be lit. And from this first flame, it will then go out to many hundred candles in the park for those who are HIV. Being there is the hardest for them because they are reminded they are going to die. It is a very hard thing to understand. If you are 60 years, it's different. But if you were 22 years old, for those who don't come, it's because they don't want to be associated and they don't want to be reminded of death. I have a friend, a very dear friend. His name is Gary. He never came for the memorial. When I met him for dinner, he said, "Pat, I'm sorry I didn't come to the memorial. I don't want to be depressed. I don't want to be reminded." And I said, "Gary, I understand. But when I die, when I go, will you come? Will you come and light a candle for me?" When the memorial starts, you stand there with your candle, and your mind, it starts to wander. It goes back and it reminisces. Your emotions, it starts to build up. Human beings, being what we are, have an aura that we exude. This aura is connected together into one huge, giant mess of emotions. For me, it is the hardest time. For when I make the announcement, it reminds me of all the pain, of all the suffering that I have seen. It's very difficult to bring it across. For a mother who has lost a son, it's a very special day. She goes there to pay her penance. But there are many hundreds of people who are there who are paying the same penance. So in actual fact, and in comfort, she's never alone.
Do you feel alone?
Sometimes.
Don't be. I'm here.
I know. It's just little moments. You know, moments when I suddenly catch a glimpse of myself in the mirror. Moments when I'm sitting in the MRT.
Yes. But don't forget other moments. Moments when a dear friend holds your hand in a taxi. Moments when you're having a meal with your family.
Why should I be different from anyone else? Why should I be special?
You don't have to be special. You just need to know why you're doing this.
I know why, but sometimes I don't. And sometimes I feel sorry for myself. And sometimes I just want to kill all these stupid people I meet.
Paddy?
Yes?
John says hi. Your mom says hi. They're proud of you, Paddy. They're so proud of you.
Can I join them?
Don't be a bitch. The answer is no.
It's ending. I need to finish it.
Yes. You finish it. And don't shut up. Even when they bang the last nail in, even when they throw you into the fire, don't shut up. The phone will ring.
The silence you get during the memorial, during the prayers, is a very unusual silence. It's silent, but at the same time, it's a voice. You just feel it. It's just there. The electricity of that silence. And yet, there is a clear voice.
Thank you.